Hi, good morning. My name is Raquel, and welcome to my podcast. I want to thank all new and returning viewers for checking me out today. Today is Sunday, the 26th of February. And first off, I want to apologize for not having uploaded any episodes for the last 2 weeks. Reason was that on the 8th of February, I went to a trusted site and the site was hacked, and the result of that was that some ransomware got downloaded onto my computer, and I've been trying to resolve those issues since then. I managed to do so last week, and I did actually film a little bit of an episode to upload last week, but then time got away from me. I had a whole bunch I filmed it in the morning, and then I had like a party in the afternoon. I got home around midnight or so, I wasn't able to complete the podcast that I had planned, so I decided not to upload it. But I'm here today. Everything's okay. It was just really just computer problems that I had. I hope to have resolved them now. I did have an antivirus, it just was not adequate to block this ransomware from being downloaded. I have since then downloaded a couple of trial versions of different antiviruses that supposedly protect the computer from this type of ransomware, and I have a program that I've been running once a week since I've resolved the problems that removes any spyware, any ransomware, any malware from the computer as well. So that's the reason that I did not podcast for the last 2 weeks. So this is going to be a slightly longer than usual episode because I have quite a lot to show you. I do have some finished objects that I no longer have here with me, but I have taken photos of them, so I will insert them at the end of the episode, or I might just pause this and insert them somewhere in between. We'll see how it goes. I already said that was 26th today. It's Sunday. We've been having a really nice warm week. It's been temperatures of 20 plus degrees, nice sunny weather, and then today I wake up and it's grey outside. There was a bit of sun before, and just as I started setting everything up to start to film, it's just grey clouds outside. So I'm sorry about the lighting. I've tried to... Yeah, I don't know, I'm probably going to have to, while this weather is like this, while we're not really in the summer yet, maybe start filming closer to the window. But I need to create a little spot over there. I'm sitting at my dining room table at the moment, and so I'm about 2 meters away from the window. And like I said, there's not very much light outside either. We're going to have to make do with what we have for today. So, finished objects, let's start with that. I'm going to start with cows that I'm running at the moment. I'm currently hosting, which is going to be finished by the end of February, so in a couple of days' time, the Stephen West Knit Along. From the activity I've been seeing on the Ravelry group, there haven't been many people participating. Only one other person, other than me, but I'm not eligible for prizes, has completed a project. So what I'm going to do is I'm just going to let run to the 28th, and then I'm going to close the thread, or I'll just leave it open, but the cowl will be finished on the 28th, and I'll just get in contact with the person who has finished a project and send her something, as she's the only one that actually participated, finished something. So I'm not going to do a prize draw, because there just hasn't been that active. Let's keep it at that. So other cows that I'm running I'm hosting, and these are 2 year-long cows. Sorry, there's a lot of fluff flying around. I was brushing the cat this morning, so there's a lot of his hair still flying around. The other two cows that I'm running are the blanket cow, so that's a year-long just knitting blankets. I've got three on the go at the moment. I'll show you those in a second. And then the other one is a stash busting pile. The idea behind that one is to use up as much stash yarn as possible. That's not to say you can't buy new yarn, just, you know, try to use up as much of your lovely stash as you possibly can. So with that, I'll start with the only finished object I... Okay, I have several finished objects, but two of them, or some of them, are part of a bigger thing. So, like, they're modular pieces. So, I suppose they're finished, but they're part of a bigger, so they're not 100% finished, put it that way. So, I'll show you the only thing I have absolutely 100% finished. There's only a couple ends to weave in on the sleeves, the rest are all woven in. And this is a little sweater I knit for a friend who's having a baby. I'm not sure if she's having a boy or a girl because she's not announced that yet, but she's due in May. And I decided to choose colors that I thought would go okay for girl and boy, and for me that's like blues and reds and stuff like that. I don't think that... I personally don't mind seeing little boys dressed in pinks or purples or something like that, but I don't know how she feels about that, so I decided to go for blues. I was using up stash. So here's a little sweater. Like I said, I have a couple ends to weave in on the sleeves. This is the flax sweater by Tin Can Knits, and I knit this in size 1 to 2 year old because my gauge was slightly off, so it's not as big as it's supposed to be for the 1 to 2 year old. It's slightly smaller, but I'm pretty sure it's going to fit her child, fit the baby by the time, you know, winter comes around. So it's not going to be a sweater for now, for May. It's going to be too warm for that, but it will definitely be something that the baby can wear in the winter time. And I came up with this little cat motif, reason being that she has a cap as well. So yeah, and I like the striping, so I decided to do striping on the sleeves as well to match the color work here. And the yarn I'm using, or the yarn I used here, is BMG Affinita's Baby, and that's 100% acrylic yarn, but it's like anti-allergic yarn, and it's like really super soft. It can go in the washing machine, so she can just throw this in the washing machine and everything. In case you guys wonder, this is what it looks like on the inside. This is not the ideal yarn to do color work in, because it's not, you know, it doesn't stick together much, but it worked out. I did create little hearts here in the middle to not have too long floats. But yeah, you can see some of the here. In this one, you can see some of the places where the white yarn comes through. Like I said, it's not the best yarn to do color work, but I wanted to do something cute with it. So that's another. That's why I like the flax sweater so much, because it's a really simple, straightforward sweater to knit, like top-down sweater, and you can just totally modify it however you like. I did the flax light for myself, and I added all those stripes with a different stitch in it and everything. So I've modified this one to add the color work. So yeah, that's the little sweater I made. This is the only real complete, like, finished item that I would consider complete, other than sewing in the ends, of course. And I might add like maybe a couple of buttons on one side, just to, because it's like you can wear it back to front, but just make it easier for the parents to decide which is the front, which is the back. So that's one item. Then I'll go straight into whips, because the rest kind of goes into the whips as well. The next thing I'm going to show you is also for this friend that's having her baby in May. And seeing as I had so much yarn, I wanted to use the rest of it up to make a baby blanket for her. This is a design I came up with last year. It's a chevron blanket. I did modify it from the one I made last year. If you've been following me since the beginning, you have seen it. It was like made in the shades of light yellow, browns, and a couple of blues in there as well. This one's completely blue, and one accent color is the red. And there's a bit of white as well. Basically, what I did is like any leftover yarns I had from the sweater I used in this blanket, and then I had a whole bunch of full skeins that I used for. So the main color here is a turquoise. So that's the main color. I do have some ends to weave in still. I haven't done that yet. So, and I did it's not identical to the one I made last year. The one I made last year, the chevron stripes were all the same width. This one I decided to do different widths of stripes. So you have this one here, which is quite large. And then you have the one in between that's smaller. So I'll just go, this is from one end. It's basically finished. So I'm here, this is where I started. I did this striping here, and then I went back to the turquoise, added in the light blue, did the turquoise. This is where we come into the leftovers of the sweater. So that's what I had left over. I had a full skein of this one, so I did divide that one up. And then the white and the dark blue is left over from the sweater. I think this was also left over from the sweater. Because I knew how many garter ridges I could get out of one ball, I divided the full skein of this color up. And so now I'm back to the color here. So I'll do that one until it runs out. And then I'll add in another stripe of the turquoise. And I'm going to have to pause right here because it's running off with packages he shouldn't be running off. So I'll be back in a second. Bye. Okay, sorry. So I'm back. Here's a little guy. He's kind of annoyed with me because he's by himself today. The dogs are at my parents' place. So he was sleeping really nicely until now. And now he's decided to wake up and create havoc, of course. So he's going to get into all the stuff that I have here on the table. Because that's what he likes to do. Hello, boy. Hello. Okay, so I was talking about the blanket. I'm just going to finish off this color. I think I have about another 12 rows or 10 rows to go in this color if it matches the other way, the other side that I did. And then there's the one more stripe of the turquoise, and I think then that's going to be like a decent sized blanket. If it isn't, I have one more of this light blue. Sorry, he's like playing with the yarn that he shouldn't play with. So I might have to add another couple of stripes if that's the case. But yeah, this blanket is almost finished. I don't know if I'm going to have it for you next week. Depends on how fast I finish this, but I'm planning on finishing this today or tomorrow. So that blanket, sorry, I'm going to grab one over here. So that blanket goes into two of the year-long cowls I just mentioned before, which were the blanket alum and the stash busting cowl, because this is stash that I have in my stash that I have, yeah, from before 2017. So just quickly, any yarn that you have in your stash that was bought prior to 2017 counts. Whips are allowed, just join in the fun. And what are you going to do now? You going to behave? Yeah? You going to behave so I can show off the rest? Okay, I think he is. So I'll quickly show you the other things so I can put away the yarn and he won't play with it anymore. Last year a friend of the podcast gave me a pattern which I've been wanting to knit for a long, long time, which was the Persian Dreams. She gave me the Persian Dream expansion pack because the Persian Dream pattern wasn't available at the time, but since then I've been able to purchase it. So I have the full 24 patterns of the hexagons, because actually it was the original Persian Dream pattern only has six hexagon motifs, and then Janice Reed, which is the designer of this pattern, came out with a expansion pack, which is what I was given by this lovely viewer, so thank you, you know who you are, Sophia. And that expansion pack had a further 17 designs, I want to say, of hexagons, and recently Janice came out with the 24th design. So there's a total of 24 hexagon designs available. There's also a worsted weight version of this pattern, and then there's the other pattern that I purchased myself as well, which is Friesland, and that is a just the Persian Dream pattern is using a lot of colors with one main color, and the Friesland is just a two-tone blanket. And when I saw the Friesland one, I said, that's what I want to do. I want to make that blanket in blue and white. That was my original idea. But then I thought, well, I'll put that one to the side. I really want to do the Persian Dreams, but I don't want to use all the colors. I like the idea of just the two colors. That's not to say that I would like to do the one with the full color effect. Maybe not with all the different colors. I might use like a self striping yarn for that, but a yarn that changes colors, like that has long color changes, like a Zauberball or what else, like a Noro for instance. But I'll just see what I can get my hands on or what I have in my stash. But what I decided to do was that I have the stash in my yarn for, I bought the first part in 2014, and then last year I bought some more. And this is from, this is 100% Portuguese wool. It's rustic, it's not scratchy at all, or at least I don't think it's scratchy. I can totally wear this next to skin. I personally think this is quite soft, but like I said, it's rustic. It's not like merino soft or anything. And like I said, I bought this in 2014 at Vila de Conde, the art fair that they have every year. And this is locally sourced yarn, spun here in Portugal as well. And I remembered, well, I have this stuff, this yarn, in my stash. I might as well use it. Now, this is like bulky yarn, so the hexagons are going to come out huge. Actually, I'll have one to show you, because I decided to start on it finally. And I can get one hexagon done in a weekend. So I'm going to start planning, having now done this one hexagon, I decided my initial plan was to do about 20 or so hexagons, or try and do them all and then maybe make some pillows out of the extra ones I didn't need for a blanket. But now seeing the size of one hexagon with this yarn, I only really need to make 7 to make a decent size blanket. That's like a lap blanket. I'll first do the lap blanket size. If I decide I want to make it bigger, then I'll make it bigger, just add a couple more hexagons. So the yarn I'm using is by Vonatur, which like I said is a Portuguese company here, and the yarn is locally sourced, and I'm using the only 3 colors that they have, which is all natural colors. None of this is dyed. So we have the plain white one. Then we have a mix, which is more of a gray color. So I'll put the white next to it so you can see the difference. And then we have the brown color, which has flecks of white in there as well. So these are the 3 colors I'm going to be using. I was planning on using, because I have more of this color, I was going to use this as the main color, so the background color, and this as the contrasting color. But I thought, well, I have this one as well, so I might as well make a couple of hexagons from this one. I just want to use up as much yarn as I possibly can. So this is what I was had left over from doing the first hexagon. I still have to wait, I haven't done so yet. I know what I had. I know how much it weighed when I started, so I can see how much yarn I actually use. But seeing as all the hexagons are different, the design on them is different, I might use more yarn in one and less yarn. So we're just gonna I'm just gonna have to see go see how much yarn I'm using as I go along. So this is the one I've just made is probably going to be the center hexagon, and then what I'm planning on doing is going around it, so using this as the main color and this as the contrasting color, and making them the other six to go around them. So yeah, let me just put the yarn away so I can don't have to worry about getting into the yarn, because even though he's really good with not chewing it anymore, when he does get confronted with the yarn in front of him, he obviously wants to go play with it. So I'm going to show you the whole thing first. I won't even be able to fit it all in the screen, but I have taken some photos of it laying out on the table, so I'll insert those at the end as well. I have not blocked this yet. I want to do another one first, see if it comes out more or less the same size, and then block it from there. Basically, I'm going to get a couple of blocking mats and pin out the size I want to get, and then block them all one at a time on there. But I'm going to wait for a bit warmer weather to come, because like I said, it was warm weather this week, and now suddenly it's like gray and looks like rain again, so not really the time to start blocking yet. And I have to block in the spare room now, because I can't block on top of my dining room table, which is what I usually did, because Soot likes to spend his days on the dining room table, and I'm scared he'll hurt himself with the pins or eat the pins or something. So without further ado, here's the finished hexagon I made. Like I said, I can't put all of it in the screen. It is bunching up here in the middle, but Denise has a different way of starting the hexagon, because this is, you start here in the center. I'm going to fold this in half so it's easier to show. So you start in the center by using a magic, I'm not quite sure what the term is, but basically you don't actually cast on the stitches, it's like a magic hole or something. You have a hole, and then if I pull this piece of yarn, it's going to close it, so, and then I just have to weave in the ends, obviously, which I have not done yet. So you start in the center by increasing stitches, and then you add in your first color. And like I said, this is supposed to be like a whole range of colors, but I went for just the two colors. And then yeah, just start knitting all the way to the end. And then I just did a fairly loose cast off. She says that you can put them on waste yarn, but I just bound it off, because I'm gonna just crochet them together, like I'm doing with the other blanket I'll show you in a minute. So I'm really liking this a lot, and like I said, this is super soft. There is still some stuff, you know, like grass and stuff in there, but that's okay. Once it's washed, that's fine. When I was knitting this on my when I put it down my lap, it's like so warm already. So yeah, my idea is to then choose seven of the designs I like, make the blanket, see how big it comes out. I think it's going to be big enough for a lap blanket I'm planning, and then I'll probably make two more and attach them and stuff it and use it as a pillow, and maybe make a whole bunch more, to make a whole bunch more pillows to put on the couch over there, so they can all be the same. So yeah, this is the Persian Dreams by Janice Reed, and I'm really liking the pattern. This is definitely a pattern that I want to finish by the, or a blanket I want to finish by the end of the year. What I've done, and I had to buy more stitch markers, but I'll show you that in the acquisition part at the end. I've used these locking stitch markers to mark off each section, so that I know when I start attaching them, I know exactly how many stitches I have in between, and I can attach them at the right spot. So yeah, I use these locking stitch markers quite a bit for this kind of stuff, So I decided to buy a couple more packages at Originator yesterday while I was there, so I can use them in this project and, you know, in future projects. So I'm just gonna put this away so that Soot can wander around here no problem. And he doesn't eat this yarn, because this is very sheepy smelling yarn still, so it really attracts him. I'd like to see when I have to. When summer comes, I'm gonna have to spend a couple weekends at the farm and wash the remaining fleeces I have left to wash. I know the reaction of the dogs to those fleeces. I'm just gonna wanting to see his Soot's reaction to the fleeces, because not only Soot, actually, I want to see the outdoor cats that my parents have at the farm. I want to see their reaction too. I know that they, whenever they, sometimes my parents leave them, like on the weekends, my dad's working out in the garden with the gardener, and then he'll leave the garage door open. And some time ago, one of the kittens got locked in the garage because my dad didn't know he was in there, and he'd gone into one of the boxes where the yarn is in, the fleece, and. So yeah, he spent the night with the fleece. So I know that they like it because of the smell. So we'll see how it is when I start washing the fleeces, if they'll get into the tubs as the dogs do. So that was whip slash finished object number two, or number three. Whip number, well, no, finished object number two and whip number two. Then the other blanket, so that was blanket number two, this is blanket number three I'm going to show you, is the pinwheel blanket, and I'm using the Karen Country Quilt baby blanket. Go check the show notes on my blog, which are linked down below. It'll take you to the pattern. It's a free pattern on Ravelry. It's not free download from Ravelry. It will direct you to the Karen website and you can download from there. So I had already done the first six blocks. I'm doing six blocks by eight blocks. And I don't know if I can't remember if I showed you the last two blocks. I know I showed you the first four. But in the meantime, I've attached this, and I don't think I've shown you my scarf, which it looks like a scarf at the moment. So I started with this block, and this is all sock yarn that I have made socks from over the past years. So yeah, I'm using scraps for the little triangles, and then I'm using this, which is the Drops Fable 107, the navy colorway, for the border around it. This is left over from my square blanket. I bought like 40 balls of this to do the border around the mitered square blanket, and I have 17 balls of that left, so I have a lot left. I can make several more blankets actually. I did all the calculations necessary after doing, you know, weighing how much I used for one border around here, and I think I'm only going to use about five balls of this. So here's the blanket or scarf, whatever you want to call it, so far. It will eventually be a blanket. At the moment, it looks like a scarf. So that was block number one. Then block number two. This is the only yarn that I actually bought without making socks. This is the Regia, my first Regia, and I bought that together with a friend. We bought like 10 little balls that we found online, and we divided that, and I managed to make a whole square in my miter square blanket, and I've made one block so far, and I can get another block out of these colors. Then number three, this was the yarn I used in all the socks I knit during March last year. Then this block is the one is from socks that I knit during October last year. And then this is all yarn from Tiger except for this blue and yellow, which is also my first regia, and this yellow and orange, again, my first regia. And this is all Yarn Adventures yarn. A couple were minis that Filomena gave me at Christmas, and others were from skeins that I've bought over the years and used. So this is the first stripe, the first row of blanket. So it starts here and there. I had originally planned on only doing 4 across, but I thought that was going to be too small, so I've done 6, and I like the width of the blanket. It's not quite my wingspan. If I'd add maybe, if I would add 2 more blocks, it would be my wingspan, but I'm happy with the 6. So I started yesterday, as it was yesterday was the Saturday, so it was the 4th Saturday of the month. That means the knit group gets together. So, and in the morning, a friend of mine was hosting a workshop at Oveja Negra, so I decided to go in the morning to Oveja Negra to lend any help if needed. I did help out a little bit, but you know, only when she asked me to. So I spent the morning at Oveja Negra knitting. I did take the baby blanket I was knitting on, but it's getting quite heavy, and it's a lot more work to, you know, pick it up and put it down. So these little blocks are a lot easier to work on and easily to put down, because you're only carrying one little ball of yarn around, and it's like fairly small to work with. So yesterday I did another, managed 2 more blocks throughout the day. And one of the block, the first block I started with, is with the same yarn I used for my October socks last year. So this is the one I made first, and this is the one I made yesterday. I'm going to try to put them next to one, and I used the same order. So because I'm getting different sections of these self-striping yarns, the blocks, the triangles come out differently. So I actually was wearing the socks I made from this yarn yesterday. As you can see, this one is the same as this one, and it's completely different. This one is the same as this one, and again, completely different. They're all, other than the gray one here, because that's just shades of gray. Those are going to be pretty identical. The rest, as you can see, is pretty different. And I have plenty of this yarn left over, so I can make, I have planned several, I think I've planned maybe 1 block per row, sorry, of this yarn. So it should be quite fun to see all the different blocks and everything. Then, again, I have a lot of Yarn Adventures yarn, because I've bought quite a lot of her yarn over the years, mostly to knit big garments, and some she has given Filomena has given me some mini skeins. So the next block I made, because I needed to take all the yarn with me, and I prefer to decide ahead of time what I'm, which blocks I'm going to make. So and again, I need to take yarn with me to knit, but I didn't want to take the whole box with me to knit. So I chose the next block for the second row as Yarn Adventures yarn. And some of them I used 2 of them, 3 of them I used in this block. So I've reused the yellow, I've reused the blue, and I've reused the brown. And the other colors are different. So this is the second block I made yesterday. So like the yellow, the brown, and the blue I already used in the other one. And then the rest is yarn from other projects that I've made. Actually, these 2 were used in a sweater I made for a daughter of a friend of mine. She actually picked these colors plus a 3rd color, but I used the 3rd color in the sweater. And you'll have seen it in the previous episodes. Actually, So, those are the first two blocks I made. And then this morning, I did one row on the baby blanket, because I've made a mistake, so I had to rip out. And I didn't feel like doing that yesterday at the knit group, so I put that down and I started working on these blocks. And then this morning, I decided I wanted to knit on the pinwheel blanket instead of the baby blanket. Again, the baby blanket is getting quite heavy now, and I can't work on it full time anymore. Even though it's sitting on my lap, it's quite heavy. It does hurt my wrists a bit, so I need to every now and then stop and knit on something with different size needles and slightly. Sorry, I'm just looking at what Sit is doing in the background. He's gonna walk past here now because he sees all the little strings. What are you doing, Sid? Hey, get out of the way. He's rolled the pencil that I have here underneath the computer. So, I decided to start a third block. I spent maybe half an hour or so deciding the next two blocks already. I don't do the whole row unless I already know what it is I want, but seeing as I don't want to get too many colors of the same. Sorry, I'm just going to remove the pencil so that it will leave the camera alone. Or the computer alone so that he doesn't mess with it. There you go. Let's play with that. Up here. Go. Okay. Let's see if he doesn't move the computer too much. So anyway, I started the third block this morning. This is from a pair of socks that was commissioned last year. And I can't remember, I know I showed them while I was working on them. I don't know if I think I only showed the pictures. These were like knee-high socks that I made for someone. Then these two yarns I made in a project together. This is Malabrigo in the Cordovan colorway, and this is, I know the name of the colorway is Pebble Splash, but I can't remember what the brand name is. This is Rendezvous sock yarn Rendezvous Forever sock, and the colorway is Precious. And then in this bag is where I keep the minis for the blocks I'm working on. So here's the yarn for the two blocks I'm going to be using. The ones I've used for this one already are still in here because I need to put them in here straight away, because otherwise Mr. Soot is like grabs them and runs off of them. So let me just put that yarn away in there as well. Now, to weave an ends, either I have to lock him up, which I don't want to do, or I have to do this somewhere else when he's not around, and that's kind of impossible. So I had to find a solution, and I saw somewhere online, and I can't remember where I saw this, I don't know if it was on a podcast or on a blog somewhere. All I know is that I saw somewhere online that someone had a small wooden box with a lid on it, and what they'd done was they made a hole in the lid, just like a finger-sized hole, so that you just have this box next to you, and when you're weaving in ends and you cut off, you just put the little ends in that box. Now, it wasn't because they had cats that get into the ends or want to chew up the ends. It was just so that you don't have all these ends. Like, usually what I usually did before having this annoying little cat was put them on the armrest, and then you're likely to knock them over, or, whatever. I had to find a different solution for weaving in ends with a cat. So what I had been doing was putting them in the project bag, but then when you're taking out your project, or more yarn, all these ends come flying out. And this is when I saw the little wooden box with the hole in it, and I was like, well, I do have a wooden box somewhere, I just can't find it right now. And I could drill a hole in the lid, but I had to find a solution in the meantime, because I really needed to weave an ends on these blocks so I could, you know, crochet them together. So what I found was... No. You're not allowed to play with a computer. No. So what I found was this. I can easily close it. This is a little jar that had that came with some face cream or something like that. I can't remember. I just thought it was a cute little jar, and so I washed it when it was empty. So what I have is I have this next to me with the lid closed. And then when I'm really not using it, I just really lock it. And then I usually have it in my... I add it here in the project bag as well. So that's what I've been doing. Putting in my ends in here, and then he can get to them. So that's what I'm going to have to do with these two blocks when I'm done with them. And so that was the blanket. Oh no, what I wanted to show you for this blanket. So this is holds the yarn that I'm for this the blocks I'm currently working on. And then I have this one, which holds more yarn. And I have these Ziploc bags with, so this is all Drops Fable in like solid colors. And then we have Drops Fable in different, like in long print colors. Then this is a collection of Regia yarn. Sorry about the glare. I'm not taking it out of the bag right now. Otherwise, I have a cat attacking me straight away. So that's a whole bunch of the Micros Regia over there. It looks like very little, but I have just enough to make one more block out of all of these colors. And then this is a... This was for the sock club that Rosario from Donna Maria and Filomena from Yarn Adventures created last year for October. And that's 5 minis weighing 20 grams each. I've not used these yet because I'm joining Sock Madness, which I'll come to in a bit. But I've checked the list of yarn requirements for this year, and looks like we'll be doing a lot of colorwork socks. Sorry, that's in the way. A lot of colorwork socks, and so I've decided not to use these minis in the blanket just yet. I want to see what kind of socks we're going to be knitting. Sorry about the movement of the camera. Sit has decided to lie down over here. So that's one bag that I have all my leftover yarn in, and then I have this box from IKEA, which has a sock blank, which was left over from my socks last year, my Christmas Eve pastel, and this. I can't. Stop it. That's all the other sock yarn. And this here is, like, on the side. Here it's Yarn Adventures, then we have some yarn from Tiger. This is the sock yarn from the first block I showed you. Stop chewing the yarn, Sid. And then in the middle here I have the Malabrigo, which is currently in here because that's one of the blocks I'm going to be doing. No, this is not your lid. We put this away so that it cannot get into any more trouble. Okay, so One more thing I wanted to talk about this blanket, and then we'll carry on with some other things. So, to keep track of all the yarn that I'm using, and the amounts that I'm using, because I like to do that, I created a spreadsheet with an Excel spreadsheet with various tabs, and each tab has their own thing. So, the first one, and I created this so I can show you, is this. So here, per block. So per block, I've numbered the blocks. See if you can see this. So I start here and I work clockwise around making the triangles. Sorry, anti-clockwise. What are you doing, sir? You just knocked some stuff out. Not particularly. And then below that, I've got, so per color, I write down the color name, the project I used it in, how much yarn I had to start with, how much yarn I ended with, and then here I need to fill in still the how many meters and yards I used up for that yarn. So I've done that for each of the 8 triangles, and then, so one sheet is one row. And then, because I like to know how much yarn I'm using in this project, so I can later put it all on Ravelry, I created another one that has a running total at the top, and then per block has a total of how many grams I used, how many stitches are in the blocks, and then also how many meters and how many yards. One of the things I started doing since, sorry, I'm gonna have to see where he's at. So, oh, he's playing with his own toy. That's fine. One of the things I started doing last year started with Nani Swimo, which is a national knit a sweater in a month, hosted by the Knit Girls, I believe, during the month of November. You have to be able to prove that your sweater, your adult size sweater, there are some rules to it, but your adult size sweater has 50,000 stitches or more to qualify for the Nani Swimo. Now, I joined Nani Swimo last year for the first time, but I joined it for fun. I wasn't in it for winning prizes. I actually managed to knit 2 sweaters, both of them way over the 50,000 stitches. But since then, sorry I keep looking that way, I'm just seeing what he's into. Since then, I've been interested in finding out how many stitches are in all my projects. That includes socks and all that kind of thing. So what I've done is, and I can't guarantee I'm going to keep this up for the whole year, because it does take some pre-planning before I start the project. I've been keeping up a running tally of how many stitches I've used in each project, and then, because I'm weird like that, I like to know how many stitches I knit that day. So having these spreadsheets help, because then I can easily say, well, I knit from row so-and-so to row so-and-so, so I can, because I have those spreadsheets, I can easily just, you know, subtract one from the other. So this is the sheet I created for the year overview, the daily stitch count. That's what I wrote. 2017 daily stitch count. And obviously on weekends I get a lot more knitting done than during the week. So yeah, that's what I've been doing. I need to update last week's because I'm not updated since Wednesday. So yeah, over, like I said, I don't know if I'm going to keep that up or not, but the other spread, the other page, so, okay, he's just put his toy in the water. I don't know what it is with him and the water, but he likes to put all toys in the water bowl. So I'm just going to remove it, sorry.
You naughty boy.
Okay. Caribbean. This is the toy he's playing with. This is a toy, like a keychain from McDonald's. I believe it's one from the Teletubbies. I used to go to the flea markets in Holland and just buy the ones that I thought were cute. This must have come in like a bag that I bought or something. So, but he likes it. He likes playing with this thing. So this keychain part makes a lot of noise and it's nice and fluffy and he likes it. So there you go. Go for it. He has another one that don't even know why that's. It's like Animal from the Muppets. He likes playing with that one too. And there's a Miss Piggy, but that one's at the farm, so he can play at the farm. Anyway, I was talking about the spreadsheets I created for the blanket project. Another page that I have I created has a running tally at the top of the page, showing how many stitches I've knit so far, how many grams I've used so far, and then the meters and yards. Now this is not up to date. The one on the computer is up to date. This is one I just created at the very beginning and just have been filling out by hand. So the red part, and I've modified it slightly since I created this. So at the top of the page, what's in red, that shows the running tally, and then again per block, just all the things I've done. So each block has a total of, and I can't, well, that was one of the things I changed because it just shows me how many stitches I have per triangle, just not the whole total. So he's playing with the pencil now. I won't show you all the spreadsheets, but another, just the last spreadsheet I'll show you is of the yarn I'm using, just to keep a track of, because some of the yarn I'm using, because, like for instance, the Drops Fable, that comes in 50 gram skeins, and I need two of them to make a whole, like a pair of socks. So I have two little balls left over, and they don't always weigh the same because not all the balls of yarn are, you know, some of them have been slightly lighter, some weigh less than 50 grams, some weigh more than 50 grams. So, and because some have used in my square blanket as well, I just keep a track of all the yarn I have. You know, so like the brand name, the color name, and then this is like, again, the running tally of how much yarn I started with, how much yarn I've used, and this is in the dark yellow, or in the yellow here, is the yarn I have left over at the moment. And then here is the 48 blocks. So I just go on to, you know, block number so-and-so and just say how much yarn I've used. And that way I know exactly how much yarn I have left over at the time. So that's just the way I organize my projects. I like to know how much yarn I've been using and the amounts I've been using. So, and I started doing that for a while now. I have a whole folder over there of all the projects. I mean, I have all the information on Ravelry, but sometimes I can't get to Ravelry and I just need something quickly to check, and that's why I have these pages that I create. If you want to know more about it, I can, you know, just ask me a question and I can go into more detail. So, the only other thing I have to show you, I think, is some stash that I bought. I wasn't planning on it, but I saw this color yesterday at Ovelia Negra, and like I said, I bought some of the locking stitch markers. These are Knitpro ones. I believe in the US they're Knitter's Pride. So just the locking stitch markers. I bought two packages. That should be more than enough for the hexagon blanket and to use in other projects if I need them. Then I've been meaning to try the carbons. Now, I don't knit my socks on DPNs anymore. I just find it too fiddly. I like knitting them magic loop. But I do use a lot of DPNs for other things, for instance for the pinwheel blanket or something. So I just decided to get the 2.25mm, which is a size I use regularly, of the carbons, just to see how I like them. And then, like I said, I was there at Radio Negra and I was helping the lady who was working there yesterday, rearranging some colors as a person had walked in. She'd had some yarn reserved for her, but in the end she decided not to take one of the colors that she'd had reserved as there weren't enough skeins or balls that she wanted. So I was just helping her rearrange some of the colors on the shelves and came across one color that I'd seen before and I'd wanted to buy before. And seeing as they were the last 12 balls there on the shelves, I decided to just go ahead and buy them now. That's not necessarily to say that I'll be knitting up the sweater right now. I'm just going to make a plain sweater out of this, most likely. I do have some other colors in this yarn, so I might use those as accent colors, but we'll see. So the yarn I bought was the Oveja Negra Donna Amelia, which is 100% wool. So it's about to steal my stitch markers and my needles. And this is the color. And here it comes, trying to steal the yarn. So this is 50 grams, has 80 meters, which is about 88 yards or so. And it's recommended to use the size 4.5mm up to 6mm needles, which I believe is a US 7 to a US 9, I want to say. I'm not sure. And like I said, I have 12 of these little cakes, so that's plenty to make a sweater. I think I'll only really need 8 to make a sweater. I'm not going to make a long sleeve sweater for sure. It's going to be a 3/4 sweater. That's what I prefer. If anything, I can always put like a long sleeve t-shirt underneath it. And this is quite thick yarn. So I've worked with this before. I've made the bobble hat out of this, and I used I can't remember. You'll have to check my Ravelry page for the project. And I've made a cowl out of this. I know the cowl I used 7mm needles because it was cabled, and I'm not sure if I'm going to use cables on this one because it's a fairly dark color, and I don't know if it's going to come out, if the cables will be visible. But I'm just going to swatch. Seeing as I have 12 balls, I can use up one little cake to knit up a swatch. I need to swatch anyway because I need to know my gauge, depending on the needles I'm going to use. I'm thinking maybe 5 millimeters. Maybe go up to 6, I'm not sure. And so I'm going to make a sweater out of this. And I just don't know when I'm going to start this. So, I mentioned before, or mentioned just earlier, that I'm going to join Sock Madness, which is something I have been wanting to join for several years now. It's just I always forget about it, and then when I remember, or when I hear about it and everything, it's already too late for sign-ups. He's really annoyed at me. He's chewing my arm. I'm sorry. So. Sock Madness. What is Sock Madness? Sock Madness is, again, something started in the US, but is joined now by people all over the world. And it's a sock knitting competition. And I think it goes on during the period of the NBA playoffs in the US, so like the basketball competition. It starts in March and it runs through towards the end of May. You have to sign up until the end of February, so if you want to sign up, you still have a couple of days to sign up. You have to go check out the group. It's Sock Madness Forever. I'll link directly to the group, and I'll link to the thread post where all the information is on how to enter the competition, so to speak. Yeah, because basically you have to, there's rules you have to follow. So don't enter, I mean, you can enter as a cheerleader, so cheering everyone else that's in the competition along, if you can't follow all the rules, so to speak. So you have to enter by sending an email to the Soft Magnets group. They have all this information. And then once you're in, on the 1st of March, the competition starts. So you'll receive a pattern by email. And I believe it eventually will go into your Ravelry library as well. But you will receive the pattern by email. And then per pattern, there'll be certain guidelines. I do believe that one of the main guidelines for the competition is that all socks must be knit to a specific measurement, must be knit exactly as the pattern is written. You cannot change anything for the competition. For your socks to be eligible for prizes in the competition. So, again, I'm joining this for fun. I'm not joining this in for a prize. If I win a prize, fine, you know, great. That'd be great. But I'm joining along for the fun and to see if I can keep up with knitting all these socks, which I believe I should be able to, because you have basically 2 weeks to knit a pair of socks, and I can knit, if I really sit down and knit a pair of socks, I can knit that, knit one pair of socks in 2 days, basically, which is what I've done before, so I know I can do that. But like I said, I was looking last week or something to see if they had the list of yarn requirements, which they usually put up, and what I've seen is a lot of color work is going to be happening this year. And I've done plenty of color work. I've just never done color work in a sock. So we'll see how that goes. I might have to not use my Hiya sharps, which is the only pair I have is in 2.25, which is the preferred size for making socks. But I might have to go up to my 2.5 Addy lace needles for the color work socks. There is currently, if you're part of the group, you are able to download this pattern, which is a warm-up pattern. I'm not going to make it. I'm going to finish a couple more squares on my pinwheel blanket. I have the baby blanket to finish off until the end of the month. So I don't think I'm going to have time to knit this warm-up pattern. But it's by Kao Coffee or something. I'll link it down below, and it's color work in the cuff section, and then textured stitches and in the foot section. And then there's also the cowl I'm going to be hosting during March, along with the Rosai from Dona Maria group on Ravelry, which is the knit along throughout March. That starts on the 1st of March, ends on the 31st of March. So March is all about socks. Now, what I have to do over the next couple of days is get all my sock yarn together, see what I have, go through the list of yarn requirements. I have to see if I have enough of the full skeins of yarn to make the socks, and then all the accent colors, so to speak. I'll just be using maybe other skeins that I have, or I'll use my minis. That's why I have not used those minis from Yarn Adventures, because I think they'll work nicely in some of the socks that they've mentioned. What I'll do, because this episode is getting way long now, and I probably you're used to me having shorter episodes, up to a half an hour or so. So this one slightly longer because I've not podcasted over the last 2 weeks. But what I'm gonna do is Tuesday is Carnival here in Portugal. I don't know if it's anywhere else. So the company has given us the day off, and so I've taken tomorrow off as well. So I'm gonna be working after I film this. I won't be editing this just yet. I'll leave that for later this afternoon because I have a whole bunch of photos to edit as well. I need to go make my lunch because it's almost 1 o'clock now and I'm starting to get hungry. I need to make my lunch. I need to prepare my soup for the rest of the week, and I have some other stuff to prepare in the kitchen, so I'm going to do that for the next hour or so, and then I'll come back and edit the podcast and edit my photos and upload this, obviously. And then on Tuesday, if I find some time, I'll squeeze in another little episode showing you all the sock yarn I have for March, and maybe some of the patterns I plan on knitting, because I have some printed out already that I want to knit. And yeah, the sock madness patterns, I have no idea what they'll be. I'll just get them as I go along, but I'll show you as I go along, and I'll show you my progress, obviously. But the other socks I had originally planned to knit for March, I already have them printed out, so I can show you those. I don't know if I'm going to get around to knitting all of them. Like I said, I'm probably going to be saving most of my sock yarn for the Sock Madness patterns, and then I'll just see what I have left over. But I'll make a little video on Tuesday and show you all the sock yarn I have. And I'll do that. Let you guys go now, because Sid's being quiet, and that's more worrisome than when he's making noise. And I'm really getting hungry. I have to go eat some food now. So, again, sorry for the super long episode today. If you're still here at the end of it, thank you for watching. And I'll be back on Tuesday with a shorter episode, just a quick overview of yarns that I have for Sock Madness and my socks for this month, for the coming month. So yeah, I'll see you on Tuesday, and then I'll see you back next week, Sunday, which is my regular podcasting day. So have a nice week, and if you celebrate Carnival, then have a nice Carnival. I don't. I suppose Carnival is the European version of Halloween. You know, people get dressed up and everything. I've seen a whole bunch of kids dressed up yesterday. But it's not something I did growing up, so it's not something I'm really into. But if you do celebrate Carnival, then have a nice Carnival, and I'll see you guys on Tuesday, and then on next week, Sunday. Bye!